Thanks, Bernie. All right, let's go. Being a broadcast anthropologist. Hi, I'm Mark, and let's see where I'm from. All the way down there in Australia. This is my house. So Australia has a population of less than 24 million. We're pretty remote. We're on the bottom of the world. And we all tend to hug around the coastline. This is our biggest city, Sydney, which I just live outside of. Oh, my gosh. Oh, now we're moving. And I actually live about an hour and a quarter to the west of Sydney at a place called Freeman's Reach in Hawkesbury District. It's rural, semi-rural, and this is where I monitor media, broadcast media from the whole world. So what are we going to see today? I'm going to talk about remoteness breeds the desire for adventure, the business of monitoring the globe, local perspective, a view on the ground, conflict and war, and exotic sounds, sights, and cultures. So when you head west from my house into towards the centre of Australia, you come to a mountain range. And once you cross that mountain range, there's nothing but desert. In fact, for 2,500 miles till you hit the Indian Ocean. There's a couple of towns, of course, and there's some cities on the other side. And the only real large landmark between my house and the Indian Ocean is the world's largest rock, called Uluru. So in such a remote place, communication is really important, just like in the United States. For economic development, communication is incredibly important. And communication in Australia is quite often by radio and by satellite. So there's a cell phone tower, and getting a feed for it is via satellite. But some place, and there's fiber, of course, some places are just too remote for fiber. And so radio is still widely used across Australia. It really is a really remote place. And you have a sense, as a teenager growing up in Australia, I had this sense of being a long way away from the rest of the world. And you Americans drove me fucking crazy because I would get comic books from the States and they had these amazing things. Like kids in America actually had submarines. Far out. And only cost $6.98. How would I ever get that? I really, really desperately wanted a submarine. And so down in Australia, you just feel, well, when I was growing up particularly, but it still hasn't changed that much, you feel a long, long way away from anywhere else. And an important rite of passage for my generation was to travel. So here's my friend Angela. She's actually a Kiwi from New Zealand, but they feel very, very similar to Australians. They're in fact slightly more remote than us. And the rite of passage is to travel to far off places. You don't go to club meds or resorts, but you go adventure traveling. And Angela and I still travel together to this day.
Can WA handle another boom?
The vast ancient land that's home to a rich Indigenous culture.
South Australian growers are expected to be hit hard.
But Russia retains some of its political mystery.
The long-running Israeli-Palestinian conflict is still at the centre of world affairs. Famine, corruption and conflict continue to dominate life.
35 years after the disaster, taking you to the most remote parts of the country.
North Asia is working to keep up with its own technological advances.
Ancient civilization, which is rapidly becoming the powerhouse of the world.
Is the focus of the government.
But what will the region's booming resources sector mean for life on the land?
Now, Papua New Guinea stands on the cusp of a resource boom.
Australia and Indonesia
closely on a number of issues.
It is here in places like Palau in the Pacific.
But is America's social divide getting wider?
Dozens of fragmented countries have been united under the EU.
Some parts of this reef haven't recovered.
Will the booming mining sector be the PM's downstream population to rise to 36 million by 2050?
Reporting from Washington,
London, Moscow,
Jerusalem,
Beijing,
Darwin,
Canberra,
Brisbane, Melbourne, Sydney.
So that's what news broadcasting looks like in Australia. It's, of course, all news is local, so there's a lot of Australian news, but we actually have a bigger mix of international news than I can see here in the main broadcast media in the United States. So in the type of coverage we have in Australia, we're probably 50% local, 50% international, or maybe even slightly more international than local news. So unlike the United States, which has is kind of like self-contained and can produce a full news broadcast just on domestic issues primarily, in Australia we tend to think a bit more globally. We understand how remote we are. So from my house, I actually have a good view, line of sight view, to a third of the planet and the satellites that cover it. The areas that really interest me are... It's hard to see with the lights up here. So the areas that really interest me are the Middle East, the Asia-Pacific region, and the Pacific region. And in fact, so the NSA and the CIA recognise that it's an important part of the world to monitor as well from Australia. So we actually have quite a number of listening posts, United States listening posts in Australia, which monitor the Middle East and Asia. I've essentially live in a, well, it's a house, but essentially it's just a monitoring station which just happens to have a bed, a kitchen and a bathroom. So signals come in, hundreds of thousands of signals come in, and by all various methods, here is radios. They're kind of like spectrum analyzers, software-defined radios. So while they're analog broadcasts, they're being digitized and displayed on screens as spectrum. And just for fun, I've still got some old-fashioned type analog communications receivers as well. And then an important source of information as well is via IP, so internet radios and so on. And the whole place is networked. I can send any piece of audio and any piece of vision to any monitor or screen or speaker anywhere in the house. All right. How do signals come in? So via satellite, via radio. Here, these are magnetic loops for medium wave and short wave radio. This is a satellite antenna for low Earth orbiting satellites. So as satellites pass over, I'm continuously monitoring for them. Microwave, UHF, VHF, virtually any frequency I can receive. And of course, for geostationary satellites, I have a whole series of satellite dishes. And there's always maintenance, there's always new construction, there's always a new project going on. So what I'm going to talk about today is about content and how it's perceived and how it's even packaged for different audiences. So of course, majority of people in this room, English is their first language. The majority of us live in first world countries. And so we're used to receiving and seeing information packaged a certain way. Probably the greatest content producer for news broadcasting is the BBC in London. So let's have a look at how they do that.
Welcome to the world's newsroom.
پیام‌های متفاوتی است که
از این طرف نشان می‌دهد برای
We call this place the world's newsroom. The BBC's new home has floor after floor of journalistic expertise. And if I need to get a local perspective on stories happening in any part of the world, I can find someone to give me just that. I want to find out local perspective on the ground. What are people saying about the new president?
Some people are very positive of the new president. It's been 20 years. People are tired.
But best of all, we can share that knowledge with you too. Welcome to the World Newsroom.
So this building in London really fascinates me, Broadcasting House. It's in central London. And in fact, I get thousands of feeds from it. Audios such as BBC Radio.
Bangalore.
Melbourne.
New York.
Wherever you are. You're with the BBC.
And their content is also broadcast across the Asia Pacific via a whole series of satellites.
This is the BBC. There is currently no service on this channel, but you can hear BBC programmes in English and Arabic 24 hours a day on one of this satellite's nearby channels. Details of all our services are at bbcworldservice.com.
So to pick up these signals, there literally are thousands of signals coming out of that building in many different languages, many different formats. You simply need to know the technical parameters on satellites and the IP addresses to receive them. I can watch domestic UK television, so can consume all of the domestic media. And you can also see studio what's happening in studios before it's packaged and goes to air.
Yep. Yeah. Okay. A new boss at the BBC, his job to lead it out of the crisis that's followed the Savile scandal. Hello and welcome to the BBC's News at 6. Less than 2 weeks after the BBC lost its Director General over the Savile scandal and its aftermath, the corporation has a new boss, Tony Hall, currently the Chief...
So how information and how news is packaged really fascinates me, and the BBC is interesting because it's targeting... It broadcasts in many different languages, domestic, international, and it packages information in very different ways. And different cultures will accept different types of packaging and different types of information. So probably a good way to look at this, let's have a look at, go back to 2011, to the fall of Gaddafi in Libya, and get an idea of how some information was packaged around that event.
But first, former Libyan leader Muammar Gaddafi is dead. He was killed after fighting in his hometown of Sirte. More details are gradually emerging over the circumstances about how he died. The Reuters news agency is quoting NTC officials who say Gaddafi was not killed immediately. They say he died after his capture during a gun battle, which broke out between his supporters and NTC fighters. His remains have been placed in a mosque in the city of Misrata. Gaddafi's son, Mutassim, was also killed in Sirte. He was Libya's former national security advisor. According to an NTC commander, his body was also taken to Misrata by ambulance.
So this is a really interesting vision.
Gaddafi's hometown, he was born there 69 years ago.
Al Jazeera comes out of Doha.
After weeks of heavy fighting.
And this is a global feed, international
feed. Been celebrating throughout the city, in the capital Tripoli, and, of course, in the NTC stronghold of Benghazi.
And you can see in the production of that news broadcast, there's no hesitation to show direct facial images of dead people and mutilated faces. So that would be pretty unlikely you're going to see that on CBS, ABC or NBC. And it's also unlikely you would see it even on Al Jazeera America. So different cultures will accept different content and graphic content as part of it. Places like, quite often countries say that they have free media, and in fact, usually if they spell it out and spend a lot of time talking about it, they actually don't. And Libya was one of those places. This is Libyan state TV. So Gaddafi's television station was primarily just a propaganda output for his regime. The technical quality of that video is exactly as received their broadcast quality from satellite. So it's like low-res YouTube-type quality vision. And it really was just promoting Gaddafi and his regime. As the country was collapsing, they would spend most days just broadcasting the crowds on the street supporting Gaddafi. As it came closer to collapse, the crowd shrunk. And in fact, this is the final day and the camera is really tight because essentially no one is out on the square now supporting Gaddafi. And by good luck, I just happened to be recording actually as Libya fell for probably 6 months, I was continuously recording the state television and captured the final moments of Gaddafi's television station. It was actually shut down, and this is how it shut down. That's it. That was the end of the regime, or at least its propaganda. And it was the end of Gaddafi as well. So let's break the law. We're going to break the law. There's some signals which are, even to Western democracies and open societies, there are some signals that are actually banned. So the vision you're about to see now, it's actually, I'm not sure it's illegal to show it in the USA, but it's certainly illegal for this station to be received in the USA. And it's Hezbollah's television station called Al-Manir. And it's been designated as a global terrorist entity by the United States, and so can't be broadcast into the country. It doesn't claim to be neutral. It claims to actually, it doesn't hide the fact that it has a particular point of view and it wants to promote it. So from their point of view, they're exposing Israeli injustice.
مؤسسة الشهيد برنامج تكفل أبناء الشهداء.
Encouraging taking up the fight and martyrdom. So as you can see, it's very slick. It's considered in Lebanon and Hezbollah territories as a legitimate entertainment television station. So you can control information by actually banning it. That station's actually banned here in the United States. It's not banned in my country, Australia. But so you can simply say to people, don't watch it. That's impossible for that station to be broadcast through American infrastructure, so American satellites don't carry the signal and so on. But if you really want to control the message, you can actually take put technical jamming measures in place to actually block signals. So for some of you that saw me talk about North Korea last year, you heard about my project there. I actually decided to actually analyze, go to North Korea many, many times and analyze the broadcast media there and the propaganda media. It had never been documented before. And so let's go on a little band scan. Let's listen to the AM radio band and the FM radio band in Pyongyang, the capital city of North Korea, and let's see what we hear. Jamming. So this is jamming. The red is where we are, Pyongyang, and it's jamming a signal from South Korea, so people in North Korea can't hear it. Oh, tune down the dial a bit more. More jamming. Now, here's a signal which is a North Korean regime signal, so it's not jammed. More jamming. More jamming. A North Korean signal, not jammed. Another North Korean signal, not jammed. Jamming. North Korean. North Korean. A North Korean. So what actually happens in North Korea is that if there's any kind of information coming from the outside world, they actually technically jam it, so it can't be heard at all. But not only do North Koreans do this, the South Koreans jam North Korean signals as well. But with software-defined radios and with high-quality filtering, you can normally get around that jamming. So here's the jamming signal. And we change the bandwidth. And now we can hear the actual signal that was being jammed. So of course the average person doesn't have this, you know, kind of radio disability. But you can usually get around jamming signals this way. So this is actually a North Korean radio service which masquerades itself as a South Korean radio station. And so hopes that South Koreans listen to it and think it's coming from South Korea. Just while we're on North Korea, of all countries, it's probably got the most bizarre television. So here is a segment out of the normal television news, just the nightly news, and they're just discussing what they would like to do to the previous president of South Korea.
Oops. 만고욕족 이명박 쥐새끼 무리들에 대한 분노가 하늘이 닿은 지금 전체 인민군 장병들은 욕족 패당의 위영수의 이른 더발과 함께를 무차별적인 보복성전으로 축탕켜버릴 멸족의 의지로 가슴 불태우고 있습니다.
만고욕족 이명박 욕족 패당에 대한 우리 부대 장병들이 치솟는 분노는 하늘에 닿았습니다. 우리의 최고 전원과 뜻깊고 성대히 진행된 경축 행사들을 두고 가둔 혼란과 악행을 저지른 개보다 못한 쥐새끼 무리들을 말려 죽어도 시원치 않겠습니다.
경축의 열병 광장에서 과시된 한계를 모르는 우리 유력한 타격수단들과 장비들을 지명박이 그 새끼는 아마도 제놈을 재가리로 만을 철추로 보지 않았던 것 같습니다. 그렇지 않고서야 어떻게 감히 우리 최고 저놈을 홀뜯는 전화무도한 망발을 또다시 제칠 수 있단 말입니까?
지명박 그 새끼 무리들을 이 땅 연월에서 흔적도 없이 죽여버리자!
죽여버리자! 죽여버리자! 죽여버리자!
정말 혼이 나갈 대로 나간 미친 놈들이 아니고서야 어떻게 그런 막말을 할 수 있단 말입니까? 이 미친 쥐새끼들이 똥무지만 싸다니면서 민족의 얼굴에 흙탕칠하고 있는데 성진 우리들이 어찌 참을 수 있단 말입니까? 쥐새끼 무리들이 아직도 살아서 신성한 하늘이 되고 미친 망발을 해대고 있는 것 자체가 수치고 말도 되지 않을 일입니다. 3, 4분 아니 그보다 더 빨리 청와대면 청와대 인천이면 인천 구 어디든 더발 원점들을 통째로 날려 보내겠습니다.
<놀려오실 수도 늦잘 수도 없는 우리 시계 버벅선전 타격이 이제 곧 지새끼 무대의 번거지들을 어떻게 쓸어버린가를 이제 세계는 똑똑히 보게 될 것입니다. 이 백두산 혁명강군은 이제 식민지 거영군인 괴뢰군 따위는 관중에도 없습니다. 정부리들 저것만 봐서 그래도 지새끼 잡아 친구 바로 내려버리고 부기세로 아래 만들었다고 완전히 타갖고 말했습니다!
Order를 마칩니다.
What a crack up. And you know, that concludes the news. Do you think you'd see that on Eyewitness News? So it kind of makes, you know, that Kim Jong-un was so offended by that Sony movie, the interview, and that's what their news looks like. Quickly going now, so it's not all war and politics. It's actually getting all of these signals, hundreds of thousands of different signals, actually means that you get this great view of cultures, society, music. It's incredible what you can see. So Channel V is a music television brand from News Corporation based here in New York. The studios are in Hong Kong, but that's their service for far western China. Now, in China, actually in most parts of Asia, the majority of people receive their broadcast, both radio and television, via satellite. And satellite dishes in this part of the world are as common as electric fans. They're just normal devices you'll find in any market. It's actually easier to buy satellite dishes than to buy radios in most parts of Asia. Places like Mongolia are fascinating because they're nomads and they actually just move the satellite dishes with them as they go around. Most of the signals are free to air. You don't have to pay to receive them, so they're advertised supported. And as you can see, as you move your earth, you move your satellite dish and take your solar panels with you. And then this is in China. You can see satellite dishes just propped up against walls anywhere at all. Anywhere that there's a lot of rain, you normally find that water bottles are really good to keep the water out of the electronics on the satellite dish. So you see some really elaborate waterproofing, like these guys here. South Himalayan, so South Asia, the Himalayan regions. Again, satellite is the main method of communication. As you can see here, these are really simple, houses in the Khyber Pass and so on. But each of them have a satellite dish on top of them. So as you can see, very exotic programming. Now, India, of course, is the largest country in South Asia. And when you look at how people consume information in India, it's really interesting that there's a high proportion of the population are illiterate, so they can't read or write. So broadcasting is very important. And country of 1.2 billion people, television being the way that most people consume information. So when you compare it to radio or to the internet, you can see that television is so vitally important in that country. So every morning there's broadcast, live broadcast from temples. This one's in Mumbai. So a massive industry, and as you can see there, the country has over 823 satellite channels, and 80% of them are free-to-air, meaning you don't have to pay. So it is, not everyone in India has a satellite dish. It's quite often there's a one dish, and an enterprising guy has built a cable network, but he charges virtually nothing for you to receive 823 channels in your house. And but, you know, the majority of houses have television. This type of programming is really popular. Hindu, epic stories. What does music television in South India look like? This is MTV, typical MTV type programming in South India. So one, we'll look at one more country and then we're pretty well done. So the Middle Kingdom, China, a really important, probably the most important country in Asia. Asia really revolves around China. So 1.35 million people, 290 different languages, 56 recognized ethnic groups. So again, television is a really important way that people collect information. And as you can see here, again, really simple structures, really basic housing. You always find satellite dishes on top of them. Over 3,000 channels available in the country, and again, the majority of them free to air.
Yeah.
So even programming for teenagers and young people uses communist pop culture, even in a country like China. This is the headquarters of China Central Television. It's a strange-looking building in Beijing. On its official opening, they let off fireworks from it and it caught a light, but it's actually survived. Now, this produces a massive amount of content. So just like I get literally thousands of streams out of the BBC in London, I probably get 5,000 or 6,000 different feeds out of this building as well. So at 6 a.m. and television is just open for the day. That's the main channel, China Central Television 1. And if, when you travel through China, this is a pretty common sight. On top of every mountain, you'll see repeated dishes and so on for microwave. Chinese entertainment. So this is traditional Chinese opera, thousands of years old, well, centuries old anyway. And it was adopted by the Maoists and the communists as a form of an art form to promote communism during previous decades. So you can see all the fundamentals of the traditional art form has been adopted to promote the political interests of the new communist government. Now these revolutionary operas are still quite popular. There's actually a whole channel called CCTV 11, which operates every day and has that type of those revolutionary operas all day. Typical Chinese house, like in most houses in Asia, and I suppose even houses in the Western world, the television is usually a pretty important feature in one of the main rooms. This is Tibetan television. I'm going to finish right on time.
I can go over a little bit? You're kidding.
That'll be a stretch. So my interest is really, probably my core interest in everything in life is about information and how information's used and actually how information influences individuals, how they act, what they believe, their faith, and all those type of things. It's amazing if you have an interest in what motivates people and so on. Broadcasting is a really interesting way to measure that, to understand different cultures. And you also see some very unexpected things on air. So while I've got tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of different signals coming into my home every day, sometimes you just turn on the television and you see the most extraordinary things.
The Meteorological Agency is warning that very high tsunami are expected in the following areas. The eastern part of the Pacific coast of Hokkaido. The central part of the Pacific coast of Hokkaido. The western part of the Pacific coast of Hokkaido. The Sea of Japan coast of Aomori Prefecture. The Pacific coast of Aomori Prefecture. The coast of Iwate Prefecture. The coast of Miyagi Prefecture. The coast of Fukushima Prefecture. The coast of Ibaraki Prefecture. The east coast of Chiba Prefecture. The west coast of Chiba Prefecture. The coast of the Izu Islands. The coast of the Ogasawara Islands. The coast of Kanagawa Prefecture, from the entrance to Tokyo Bay to the west. The coast of Shizuoka Prefecture. The coast of Wakayama Prefecture.
So that's it. So with that kind of hacker mindset, you can get all of these signals. Some are just there to be tuned. Others, you actually have to, we trade codes and the technical parameters of signals that they're not intended for the general public to see, but there literally is hundreds of thousands of different things that you can watch and listen to, which make the world a really interesting place. Thanks for your time.
Really eye-opening stuff, Mark. Any of us who want to get interested in this, the cost of entry isn't necessarily terribly expensive, even though your setup looked, your monitoring post looked pretty advanced. Are there any websites or other information you could share with how people can get started in free-to-air reception of satellite signals and shortwave?
Sure. So for shortwave radio, for broadcasting in general, there's a really good one called swling.com. So one of our mates, Thomas, runs that. For satellites, if you just Google free-to-air satellite, if you put the words free-to-air and satellite in there, you'll find many different sites. There's one called Linksat, which is actually a directory of all many of the technical parameters, what you need to feed in to satellite receivers. All satellite receivers these days are digital, so you need to know the data rates, the error rates, and so on. And you get all of those codes and you feed them into the receiver, and then channels start to appear.
And that's Lingsat, LYNGSAT.com, I believe. It's really, for like a few $100s, you can see some of this stuff that you would not be able to get over cable or internet, and you're missing out on a lot of fascinating stuff. Thank you, Mark.